our Friday lecture series. And perhaps I should wish all of you a very happy Lunar New Year. It's coming around the corner. So tonight we have a very interesting discussion on the Chinese as a model minority. And now we're going to have a presentation about the other side of the story. And we have Dr. Desiree Chin, who received her doctoral degree from Harvard University, and she is currently a postdoc fellow at Teachers College at Columbia University, and her research focuses on immigration, adolescent development, and education. In her current research, she is examining the psychological adjustment of Chinese-American adolescents, particularly the impact of parent-child relations and school factors. And she is a very well-published author. She is she published a book called The Gender Expectations and Gender Experiences, Immigrant Students' Adaptation in Schools. She's also a co-editor of a six-volume series called Interdisciplinary Perspectives on the New Immigration, as well as another book called Globalization, Education and Culture in the New Millennium. Please welcome our speaker, Dr. Desiree Chin.
Thank you so much, Dr. Tim, for your wonderful introduction, and I'm really very happy to be here really to discuss some of my recent work on really this whole issue of model minority, really the other side of the model minority, looking at some of the psychological and social adjustment of this population of students. A lot of my previous work really has been on immigrant students, first generation immigrant students. So today in the lecture, I'm going to present some of the findings from that study really on immigrant students, and also really to contextualize a little bit of the discussion, really looking at some of the findings from other studies on the psychological and social adjustment of Chinese American adolescents. I think most of the work I'm going to discuss today are related to Chinese American students, but some of the issues you also find really relevant to other groups of Asian students as well, some of the family issues or some of the peer issues. So I really very much look forward to having a discussion in the end with all of you about some of these issues. So we know since the 1960s, Asian American students have been documented to outperform students from other ethnic groups, including the whites, in standard test scores or, you know, in their high school GPA. They have very low high school dropout rates. They have very high, you know, college enrollment rates. In Harvard, 18% are Asian American students. UC Berkeley now, you know, we have over 30%. So at MIT, we have over one-third who are Asian American students. We're all really very familiar with a lot of these images of students doing really well educationally. And I think one of the consequences, you know, of this high achievement, this image, really it contributes to this really dominant image of Asian students all being great students, no problem, right, at home, no problem at school, they're completely problem-free. As a result, most of the research we find on this population of students really has been focusing on their educational achievement. Scholars have been trying to understand why are they doing so well? You know, what are students doing at home? What are parents doing? You know, what are some cultural factors that lead to such high level of educational achievement? And I think it really has two consequences. It ignores the diversity, right? Not everybody is doing well. Not all the Asian students are doing well in terms of educational achievement. And another very serious consequence, it creates this image of a problem-free student that doesn't need any help. You know, the student is completely, you know, the home is problem-free, the school, you know, it's just really well-adjusting student. The teachers, we don't have to worry about it, you know, they're doing well, they're not creating any problems. So it's really this lack of attention to the challenges or the difficulties students face in their schooling or at home. So this is really the focus of my work. And as leading psychologists Stanley Su and Daryl Tsu noted in their recent review of research on Asian American youth and adolescents, that there's really a lack of research, particularly, you know, on the psychological adjustment. We have very few national, you know, studies, large-scale studies, trying to understand the prevalence of depression or prevalence of anxiety or a lot of the psychological disorders. And some of the previous studies, earlier studies published on this topic, also, you know, sometimes it's hard to tease out demographic factors. For example, you know, maybe most of the students measured were from lower SES classes, so, you know, they're poorer, so maybe they have lower level of psychological adjustment. So it's confounding factors. Or, you know, some of the studies only measure immigrant students, so the generation status become confounded with mental health. And response style is another issue. Sometimes, you know, in interviews or in some of these psychometric measures, people want to respond in a favorable way. You know, they want to have this image of themselves, this adjusting better than they do. Or some of the studies point out that personality issues, you know, like some of the Asian, the typical, stereotypical, you know, personalities related to Asian people, like being shy or a little bit more introverted or more really other directedness, really to create group harmonies, you really direct attention to other people. And that usually is really seen, you know, when psychologists measure that, then they're likely to think, okay, they have lower self-esteem. Or so there are a lot of issues related to studies of psychological adjustment. Another challenge, I think, in, you know, why we don't have large-scale national studies is also the Asian American population is relatively small compared to Latino and African American population, also very diverse, right? So it's very hard to get a sample, you know, of everybody, representative sample for statistical analysis. Also, this whole image of students doing well has been really contributing to lack of funding, you know, like National Institute of Research or, you know, mental health, a lot of these agencies are reluctant to give funding, you know, to Asian American related studies on psychological adjustment. Nevertheless, previous page. Nevertheless, some of the recent findings, if we look at the result from a couple of recent large-scale studies, we find a very disturbing scene. I mean, we all know, you know, the educational achievement is really high relative to other students, right? Even the white students. But if you look at, for example, depression, national studies show that Asian American girls between the age of 15 and 24 have the highest depression rate and highest suicide rate of all the ethnic groups, much higher than Latino girls, than African American girls, than white girls. And in studies, Asian American students also have been found to be more withdrawn and depressed, particularly compared to the American norm, to the white peers. Recent studies also find they have high level of anxiety, particularly related to test taking or, you know, in academic settings, a low level of self-esteem. And I think the issue of psychological adjustment, a lot of the depression, anxiety, really, and recently suicide, has generated a lot of community concern about this issue. Like some time ago in San Francisco, a boy committed suicide really, you know, generated a lot of discussion in the community about what happened, you know, why did the boy do that. And if we look at some of the data, national data shows that suicide for all the teenagers, you know, between age 15 and 24, is the third leading reason for death. But for Asian American youth, between the age of 15 and 24, is the second most important. The first most important is just injury created by, you know, not being careful or unintended injuries. And a recent talk given by Cornell University counselor noted that 50% of the completed suicide at Cornell undergraduate students are completed by Asian American students. So it's really, we begin to see more and more, and you know, at different parts of the country, we begin to really read more and more. Like 2 years ago, I was working at a Boston very competitive exam school, and a Vietnamese girl killed herself. Very high achieving, like she was, you know, on all the school teams. She was perceived as very successful, and then really there was just too much pressure, or you know, something happened at home. The student committed suicide. So we really begin to see more and more students crashing, really under, you know, the pressure. Or so it's really important, I think, for research now for us to really understand, try to understand what's happening, you know, with the students. On the one hand, we see really good educational achievement, but what's happening with the psychological and social realm at home and at school. And recent years, we also see more studies documenting the external disturbances, because things like depression or anxiety or, you know, self-esteem, those are all internal disturbances, right, within the student. External disturbances refer to like gang involvement or juvenile delinquency or, you know, violence or felonies. We really begin to see more. For example, in New York, between 1993 and 1997, for the whole city, juvenile delinquency rate actually went down 8%. But among Asian American students, youth during that period of time, it went up 38%. So again, I think, you know, because of the dominant image of Asian students being, you know, good students and really well adjusted, a lot of these issues, you know, both in terms of internal or external disturbances, really have been ignored by the research. And there has been particularly two populations in recent research about psychological maladjustment. One of them is really, a lot of research has been done recently on college campus. I think since actually the 1970s, when Stanley Hsu and Daryl Hsu, you know, when they first started doing research in UC campuses, documenting, you know, the level of depression, the level of anxiety in college students, we really started to see like consistent findings since the 70s about Asian American students in college really struggle more in terms of social adaptation, in terms of social relations. You know, they are documented to have higher rates of depressive symptoms. They have more social anxiety. They're more likely than white students to feel lonely or depressed or isolated. And another population, it's really, researchers pointed out that recently arrived immigrant students, they are more likely to demonstrate a lot of the internal disturbances like anxiety or depression. And it's really not surprising, right? Because if a lot of the language issues, you know, adaptation issues for newly arrived immigrant students, so it's really not very surprising there. So in my work, I really am trying to figure out, you know, what happened, what is happening, right, with the Asian students in school that lead to this pattern of what I call an achievement adjustment paradox. you know, with high achievement but low psychological adjustment. So why did this happen? You know, what are some factors that really contribute to this pattern, and what can we do about it, right? I think it's really important for us to understand the context, understand the peer context, school context, the home context. Then we can figure out ways to really address some of the issues. So my work really is more ecological, really looking at the different context. The ecological model of child development indicates that, you know, a child develops in these interrelated multiple contexts, like the peer, the school, the home. So in the next section, I'm going to present a little bit more about really findings from the study I work for at Harvard on immigrant students, on some of the peer, school, and home issues. Also contextualize that, you know, in some of the other research findings. So a lot of the findings will come from the longitudinal immigrant student adaptation study at Harvard. It was part of the Harvard Immigration Project. It was co-directed by Marcelo and Carollo Soray Orozco. It's really an interdisciplinary comparative study. We were trying to follow 400 students from five different countries and areas, from Central America, China, Haiti, Mexico, the Dominican Republic, follow them for 5 years, looking at educational achievement and also looking at psychological adjustment. You know, we interview the parents, we interview all the students, you know, each year, we interview the teachers, we went to the school to do some of the ethnographic work. And the Chinese sample, we have 80 students, and they're all from the Boston area. The average age at the beginning of the study is 12. So what I did for this presentation is I want to give you a sense of the Chinese students, their experiences relative to the rest of the study, the sample, you know, all the other students. So for example, if we look at GPA, we follow them for 5 years, you know, from report cards, then the blue bars is the Chinese, then the purple one is all the other groups. We can see, you know, as expected, right, in the literature, Chinese students consistently did better than the other students in the sample in terms of educational outcome. However, if we look at how students feel, right, about themselves, given the context, they did so much better. For example, we asked them, you know, are there things that you like about yourself, you know, or I'm able to do things as well as others, I'm happy with who I am. You know, these all measure students' self-concept, their self-esteem. We see Chinese students are much less likely than the other students to report that they're happy with who they are. If we look at the third columns, then we see about 35 to 37% of Chinese students saying, I am happy with who I am, compared to about 80% of the students from the other, from the rest of the sample. And when I look at the, you know, the peer relations at school, in the interviews we ask the students about their relations at school, you know, do peers support them, or do they experience, I mean, their, you know, relations at school with friends, with other students. And what we find is that Chinese students, they experience very high level of peer discrimination at school. For example, 45% of the students we interviewed reported peer discrimination, meaning other students in the school, you know, say bad things about them to them, very rude, or they push them, or they bully them, or, you know, or just call out very racial slurs or terms on their face. And in the final year of our interview, more than half of the Chinese students in our sample reported that ethnic tension at school, meaning between different groups of students, creating a lot of problems for the students themselves. These percentages are also much higher than for the other immigrant students. And this is a very typical quote that we get from the student interviews. For example, this 13-year-old girl said, "I was beaten and bullied here in the US. It seldom happened to me in China. Like when I'm in a park, you know, they'll throw things at me for no reason. They bully us all the time. They call us bumpkins," or, you know, girls from the countryside. This is a very, we have really consistently so many quotes like this. Students talking about peer bullying happening in the classroom, sometimes really in the presence of teachers, which is very disturbing, because when other students see, you know, when this happens, teachers don't do anything about it, then they feel encouraged, right? We can do more of it. Students also talk about this happening on the school bus or in the school, you know, in the hallway when they're walking around, or in the bathroom. You know, other students will not let them go in, or they would slam the door on them. It's really a very disturbing pattern that we have seen in the study. And, you know, then we asked them, so what are some reasons you think that contribute, right? I mean, why? Why do you feel you get, you know, Asian students get picked on at school? And students talk about, you know, immigration status. You know, if I'm a newcomer, I come here, and other students make fun of my English, you know, they, so language ability is a very big reason students talk about. And then the whole model minority image, indicating that, you know, students talk about how other students resent the fact that, you know, why are all the Asian students doing so well in school? You know, why are all the honor classes Asian students? So there's this resentment from other students that also contribute to this hostility, really, towards Asian students. And some of the boys in our study also talk about, you know, physically they feel smaller, they're not as masculine, you know, they don't do as much sports. So some students feel like it's easier, right? Asian students, maybe they're weaker, it's easier to bully them. Or so these are some of the factors. And again, I think it's really particularly disturbing that school teachers and authorities quite often are not doing anything to really intervene on the students' behalf, to really do something about the issue of peer bullying. And other studies have also found that really Asian students, they report the highest level of distress related to peer discrimination. And there's also increasing media attention in the last couple months about the issue of peer bullying. Like USA Today recently had a very high profile article about this whole issue of peer bullying against Asian American students. And they used the example of one student from a Brooklyn high school that peer bullying in that school got so bad that the Department of Justice to come in and, you know, really ask the school to have some policy to curb this issue. So it's really not, what we are seeing is not an isolated incident. It's really happening quite prevalently. And then another issue I looked at is really the issue of perceived support Asian students or Chinese students in our study, they feel at school. And what we find in this study is Chinese students perceive the least support from school, from teachers and other adults. They also tend to have the least positive attitude towards their school. For example, we measured perceived support at school with an 11 item measure in the last 3 years of our study, and we can see the Chinese students, what they reported is in the purple line on the bottom. So in the final year it picked up a little bit, but still consistently they reported like less support from the teachers and adults at school compared to the other students. For example, close to 30% of students we interviewed, Chinese students we interviewed, said that no one at school made them feel like a successful student. Close to 30% of students interviewed said there was no adult they could count on at school. And again, close to 30% of students believe they could not talk about troubles with anyone at school. These are all some of the measures we use to measure perceived support at school. And all of these percentages are much higher than students from other groups. And, you know, when we ask them about how do you feel about school, you know, do you like going to school? We again see that Chinese students, they really are more likely to say they sort of don't like school or they really dislike school. And it's really not surprising, you know, given the context of if they perceive less support at school or if they really perceive a lot of peer discrimination at school. So it's really not surprising students have a more really negative, right, attitude towards school in general. And in my work, I really particularly am interested in the whole issue of, you know, the relationship at home between parents and children. So the home context is really one of the focus of my work. And I think most of the research, if you do a research, you know, a literature review, or do a search on, you know, Asian American parents and their children, what you're going to find is really most of the research has been focusing on, you know, what the parents did to contribute to their high level of achievement. You know, all the investment parents, they took them to different classes, they have tutors, or, you know, they really imbued this importance of education into the students. So we have a lot of research really on that, on the contribution Asian American parents have made to students' educational achievement. However, I really argue we know very little about the psychological aspect of, so what's happening at home? What is parent-child relation like? You know, how do parents and child, how do they communicate? How do they feel about each other? Do they feel close with each other? Do they have conflicts? So the psychological aspect of Asian American homes is really one area we know much less about. And what I find in the Lisa study is really Chinese parents and children are much more likely than the other students to be alienated at home in their relationship. For example, parents and children, they, in the interviews, talk about trouble communicating with each other. We have about a quarter of the Chinese parents in the final year interview talking about having trouble communicating with their children, and not for language reasons, for reasons other than language. And parents also, Chinese parents are more likely in the interview to say, you know, we have conflicts at home, but then, you know, I don't know how to resolve these conflicts. So a lot of the conflicts, you know, get unresolved. And students also in the interviews, they're more likely to say, you know, they don't want to tell their parents about things compared to the other students. There is a lot more reluctance to talk to their parents at home. And I will read you two quotes from some of our case studies that are pretty representative of the parents and children's voices. For example, Mr. Lai, father of a 17-year-old boy, he said, now he doesn't want to communicate with us. This is a father, actually, I work with for 3 years. And in the beginning of our study, he really talked about, you know, being very close to his son, who, you know, each time, like, we tried to arrange an interview with his son, we had to talk to the father, because the father knew his schedule so well. You know, he knew everything what his son was doing. And in the interviews, the son talked about how he really admired his parents. He wanted to be like them. He wanted them to work, you know, less hard. So it was really, in the beginning of our study, it was very close parent-child relationship in the family. But by the end of our study, 5 years later, when I did the interview with Mr. Lai, like even after I turned off the tape recorder, he consistently, you know, he wanted to talk about how nowadays, you know, his son doesn't want to talk to him. This is what he said. Now he doesn't want to communicate with us. Many important or deep things, like value, how a person should live his life, he doesn't want to talk to us about. I think with his friends, he probably would talk about them. He used to be little and that was fine, but now there's just not that much we can discuss. Even like things in people in school, he doesn't want to talk and we do not know. He really talk about his son every day coming home and just, you know, want to shut himself in his room and, you know, not wanting to interact. And each time he asks him a question, you know, what's happening at school or what happened with your test or anything, then, you know, the son just gave him very simple yes or no answers. So this is one quote from our parents. And then in the student interview, students also talk about this reluctance, wanting to communicate with the parents. For example, Carl, a 15-year-old boy, he said, "No, I don't want to go home. There's nothing to do at home. Before, when we were in Hong Kong, sometimes we sat down and talked. It happened more often in Hong Kong than here. Here in the US, we have to work. Even if we have time to talk, I mostly stay in my room. When I get home, I stay in my room to play with the computer, listen to the music, sleep, whatever. I just cannot communicate with my parents. I don't know what to say." So, I mean, the issue of, you know, children communicating less with the parents is not that surprising, right? I mean, if we think about the children reach adolescence, then they want to form their own identity. You know, they want to focus more on their peers, less on their family. It's not completely surprising saying, "Oh my God, you know, why are only the Chinese kids doing this?" That's not true, right? I mean, it happens with American kids, it's happened with, I mean, a lot of adolescents maybe all over the world. But what I really feel like important to communicate, like in this study, is a lot of, you know, developmentally, right, being a teenager, that can be one reason for this alienation at home. But there are other reasons really related to immigration or related to the clash of cultures that really exacerbate, make a lot of these dynamics really even worse in Chinese immigrant families. So, for example, immigration-related factors, in our study we find quite often, you know, parents immigrate to this country, they work in a restaurant or they work, you know, in some type of service type jobs with very long work hours, then it's really hard for them to even, you know, see their children, let alone communicate with them. This one girl I work with, Ling, for 3 years, both of her parents work in a restaurant. And every day, the schedule in the family is such that the parents would get home, you know, from the restaurant work at 11 or 12 at night. And at that time, you know, she and her sisters are already asleep. And then the next morning, she gets up at 6 or 7 to go to school. But the parents wouldn't get up until 9 or 10, right, to go to work. So the schedule, you know, between the parents and the child, they overlap very little. There's very little overlap. And Ling said in our interview, "I have dinner with my parents once a week. The rest of the time I basically, you know, in weekends. We don't really see each other that much." So it's really, I think before immigration, in a lot of families, usually one parent work. After migration, there's really a lot more pressure, you know, to survive, to really pay the bills. So I think the long working hours or really the schedule conflicts, the lack of overlap is a very important contributing factor to the alienation that happens in our study. Another issue is really the acculturation gap and the language barriers. And language barriers, we really find that very acute towards the end of our study. Because as children begin to learn more English, they begin to forget a lot of their native language. And it's really, because quite often language barrier is not just an English-Chinese issue. you know, sometimes you have a lot of different dialects involved. For example, one family I work with, both of the parents speak Fukanese, and then that's their, you know, native language. And then the girl, at first she spoke Fukanese, then she went to school in a bilingual program, so she picked up Cantonese, and, you know, on the way to learn English. And she also speaks Mandarin with a lot of her friends. So her Mandarin and her Cantonese are much better than her Fukanese. So she really talked about the challenge. She said, you know, quite often, I want to communicate with my parents, but I cannot. You know, a lot of the simple things like, you know, it's time for dinner, or, you know, it's 8 o'clock, or time to get up. Very simple, superficial level of communication parents and children still have no trouble with, right? But then it's really the deeper level when you talk about emotions, feelings, or thoughts. That's really the part of the language that get lost over time. And it's exactly that level of language you need when you want to build closer interpersonal relations. So, and another concept I developed for the issue of alienation in Chinese families is what I call a parallel dual frame of reference. Dual frame of reference is a concept developed by anthropologists talking about how immigrants, they come to this country, you know, life may be really hard, but they constantly compare their experiences here with experiences back home. So they're willing to work long hours, you know, they can endure hardship. But I argue, really, in immigrant Chinese families, parents and children, they develop very different dual frame of references. So parents, they are more likely to compare their children, you know, their children's behaviors to children in China. That's where the parents come from. That's the expectation that they have in their mind. They want their children to conform to. Or, you know, sometimes they compare their children's behaviors to their own experiences growing up. So that's what happens with the parents, and they would complain, right, that children growing up here are really, you know, not obedient. They really, you know, they want too much freedom. And at the same time, for children, you know, who came here at a relatively young age, and they are more likely to pick up the American, you know, values or beliefs, or and they compare their parents with American parents, with their friends' parents, or with what they see on TV. So over time, you know, parents want their children to be more Chinese, children want their parents to be more like American parents. So they really develop very parallel expectations for each other that just really don't meet. So I argue that really contribute to a lot of the family conflicts at home, and really contribute to alienation in immigrant families. So some other studies have also talked about the difficulty of parent-child communication. For example, the whole issue of, you know, high pressure parents have for the children, like to do really well, because parents believe, you know, efforts. As long as you work hard, then you can do anything, you know. So that really contributes to a lot of the pressure students or children feel. I think academic pressure is such a double-edged sword, right? On the one hand, it can really motivate the students to do really well. They really internalize a lot of the parents' expectations or, you know, pressure to do well. On the other hand, I think it really creates a lot of the tension at home. Like students in our study talk about how, you know, they do really badly in a test, they will not tell the parents because the parents will be really disappointed, and, you know, and then a lot of the communication around making mistakes. One study talk about how Asian parents have a harder time distinguishing mistakes with, you know, being faulty, like the Chinese word for mistakes, 错误, and then there's very direct link with being bad, or so it's really hard for parents and children to really talk about really the gray area. You know, it's okay to make one mistake. It's okay to, you know, not do extremely well in one test. So like communication around issues like that will also bring up a lot of conflict or a lot of tension at home. So in this presentation, I really talk about the issue of peer relations and how we find that Chinese students, they experience high level of peer discrimination at school, higher than the other students in our sample. And I also discuss the perceived support at school, how Chinese students, they are really perceive the least support at school from teachers and other adults. And at home, parents and children in Chinese families are more likely than the other families to experience really alienation in their relations. So what is the, I think it's really research at this point on the psychological adjustment of Asian students. We really still need a lot more work, a lot more research. Like there's so much diversity really within the Asian American community, you know, within the families, within the students' experiences. It's really, we cannot generalize, you know, a lot of these things to all the students. It's important, I think, for future research to really look at a lot of these issues with different population of students, students from different generational status or from different socioeconomic background, from different ethnic groups. And I think the practical implication really of some of the work is for us not to equate silence with stability. I think at school, particularly in the school context, that happens quite often. You know, when students just sit there silently, you know, not causing any trouble, then they're assumed to be doing well, right? You know, teachers don't have to worry about them because they're not causing any trouble. I think it's really important for educators, really for schools to be aware of some of the challenges, some of the difficulties that students face, and really try to promote the healthy development of Asian students. And the issue of peer bullying, I think we really need more school level and also national level really policies to address these issues instead of just letting it, you know, go under the eyes of everybody. And communication with parents, I think schools can also do a job to really bridge the gap between the parents and the children. And communities can also be very helpful in doing that. Like some of the studies that I was looking at cite very successful community programs, really trying to help parents and children communicate better. So, and in my own work, in the next step, I'm really hoping to understand some of these issues in the larger context. I just got a small grant from the WT Foundation to look at some of these issues in Stuyvesant, actually. That's what I'm hoping to do, like a very high-achieving, school. So look at how do students deal, right, with the psychological pressure. And so that's it. Thank you so much. What are some questions or? Yeah, please.
Some of the successful community programs that you mentioned, what kinds of programs are those?
Like,
can you repeat the question?
What are some of the programs that have been written in the research? One of them is the South Cove program in Boston, and it's really like provides mental health for the Asian American students. But they really, you know, instead of, because there's this, I think quite often a lot of trepidation, right, in the Asian families. A lot of the parents feel like, you know, I don't want to go to, you know, mental health clinic to, you know, with my students. There's a lot of shame, a lot of really associated with that. So what they do is really, for example, they would run programs in restaurants or in schools, you know, in centers, in community areas not really directly linked to mental health or psychological services, which really proved to be very helpful. They also integrated some of the, you know, the Asian beliefs about psychological adjustment, the holistic, you know, understanding of the connection between the body and the mind. So instead of just imposing this model, this Western psychology model on the parents and children, you know, they really try to understand how parents understand these issues and bring them in. So that's one program. Another program is in San Francisco, Chinatown, they have a child development program. And they also work very closely with the parents. It's also a very successful program. But I think the most important thing is really try to understand a lot of these issues from the perspective of the culture itself. Try to bridge that gap. So those are two programs that have been very successful. Yes.
An example that kind of illustrates the dual, parallel dual frames of reference. It's like some, I guess I don't know if it's a topic or an incident that mm-hmm. shows how the child and parent are being acculturated differently.
Mm-hmm. For example, in one of the families that I work with, both parents and children talk about the concept of privacy. For the parent, from the child perspective, he talk about privacy. No, not privacy, I'm sorry. Talk about the concept of respect. So the father gave me the example of, you know, each time we have somebody coming to the house, it's my colleague or somebody, then my son just says, hi, you know, then that's it. He never addressed, you know, my colleague like uncle or auntie, because like in the Chinese culture, that's what you're expected to do, you know, like an elderly, somebody older come, instead of just saying hi to the parent, it's really very rude. Like it's not polite at all. And so that's the parent's perspective, right? Respect, that you do not respect my colleague. And then the child at home talk about how his parents do not respect his privacy. So that's how he understands respect. He would talk about, you know, my mom would just come and vacuum in my room and look at my journal and look at my, you know, writing, my composition. So, you know, he got really upset by that, because for him, respect is more, you know, my individuality, my own privacy. So that's one concept that you can see how parents and children look at it from very different perspectives. Is that clear? Yeah, please.
In terms of the programs, how do you get, for example, the school to buy into some of these analyses and proposed solutions?
Mm-hmm. I think one of the problems really with current state of research, it really stays, right, at the level of research. Because right now, I guess we still know so little, like some of the things that I presented. Like if we go to a school, you know, people have no idea this is happening. So I think the first step, it's really important for like researchers to really understand more of the challenges or difficulties of what the students are going through. And then the next step is really to work with the schools to address some of these issues. And the LISA study, we actually, we didn't like have a component, you know, working with the school to really address a lot of these issues yet. In the next phase, like of my own work, I definitely am hoping to do more intervention work.
I just want to, you know, raise one thing about some of the discrimination that the students feel. I think that at Lafayette High School, in Brooklyn.
Mm-hmm.
So it becomes a very big issue on with the mass media, right? With the ethnic media, and then to a point where the federal investigators came in, and then to the replacement of the principal, and now substituting with some Chinese principal.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm just wondering about the role of media in this approach.
Right, right. So that in that case, it's because of media intervention, the exposure, right, then brings intervention to the school. I think really in the last couple years, like of doing this research, I begin to see more and more media coverage, about stories like Asian student suicide or peer bullying. So we really begin to see more. But really before this period, there's nothing really on this topic. So I think the silence, a lot of the silent struggles students face, I think are beginning to be exposed, both in the scholar literature and also in the media. You mean the media attention to that?
Mm-hmm. Since peer bullying, since Columbine, because I'm kind of wondering, ever since that happened, it seems like there's a lot of talk about peer bullying. And, I'm just very curious if that, maybe helps bring attention to this problem
right.
for Asian American.
Right. So like a rippling effect,
yeah.
right? Of that happens, so really make media look more at the issue of what's happening between students,
right?
Right. So that, I mean, that might be very well be, a reason for that. But I think it's really also just the level of peer bullying. I think it's really, if you like, in my own experiences talking to people, it's not at all a new topic. Like suddenly this year, all the Asian students are experiences at all. That's definitely not what has been happening. It's been happening like for a long time, and some researchers like Peter Kyung, at UMass Boston and other, they have been really writing about it, they've been talking about it at different meetings, conferences, but I think not until very recently, it still to generate really more media. I think it's really the level of it really build up, and then some of the Columbine or other related incidents put more people's attention more, in the school setting. Might also, that's a good point.
Mm-hmm. Your study is concentrated on, the finding out, about all these problems. Are there any organized efforts in educating the parent groups or student groups or consultation for the parents, the Chinese parents and the Chinese students.
So really to present some of the issues and help parents.
Knowing these problems, but what's being done to, counteract these problems that you have brought up?
In our study, like I said, we didn't really have an intervention component. What we really, like in my own work right now, I'm really hoping to do, really work more closely with the community to organize, for example, some parent meetings, to talk about some of these. But there are a lot of challenges, if you want to bring together the parents, like the scheduling, I think it's really, we have to be very creative about doing that. Like even the PTA meetings, sometimes parents, have a hard time going to, right? So it's really, the program would have to be developed, catering really to the needs of the parents and figure out creative ways to do that. But I would welcome, any of you who have worked in similar, if you have ever worked in intervention programs like this, I would love to hear your experiences, because that's really the concern about how to do it to really make it most effective for parents. I think really, even in the interviews, the parents were just so happy to be able to talk about it, because they really have no idea, you know, what's happening, and they were very perplexed by it. Like, I remember one of the parents I worked with called me one day, and I was really surprised, and, you know, she said, you know, my son just went to high school, and now he came back, he doesn't talk to me at all. He just become a completely different person. And the mother asked me, well, you've worked with him for 3 years. Do you think he's a good boy, you know? Like, she starts to question, you know, the personality of her son. So there's really a lot of struggle on the parents' part about this whole alienation and lack of connection. I think it would be tremendously helpful for parents to be able to hear, right, from other parents who are also experienced this, and to be able to talk about it in a community, and then together really to think about ways to make it better. I think it's really important to do that.
First, how did you recruit those families into a study? Mm-hmm. Second, what's the demographic background like among your samples? Did you try to control some of the socioeconomic variables to mm-hmm. see if there's any differences in the psychological outcomes?
Mm-hmm. That's a really good question. In this study, what we did is we really recruited students from the larger Boston area. It's not at all a random sampling. It's a convenient sample. We really send out research assistants to talk with the principal, you know, to try to recruit. And the sample itself is really largely corresponding to the national Chinese American population in terms of socioeconomic background. We have about 75% to 80% of the students, the families come from like working class background. We have about 20% or a little bit less who come from professional background. You know, both parents get college degree education. So it's definitely, like a lot of the issues that I talk about, like the long working hours, right? That's very much an economic issue, right? If like both parents, you know, work in university or they have a 9-to-5 job, then they would have more overlap, right, with their children. They can spend more time. So definitely they are influenced, what I presented, by the demographics of the, of the study.
And does that change after socioeconomic, like
the parents'
relationship
with
their children,
mm-hmm.
depending on the parents' like, economic or
social standing? What we noticed, the change is, I have 2 points about that. In the beginning of the study versus the end of the study. So relationship become more alienated. Mm-hmm. And then in terms of SES, I mean, it's really what I find in this is that both types of families, you know, like lower SES families or middle class families, both families experience alienation, mm-hmm. like over time. But the contributing factor, you know, what lead to alienation tend to differ a little bit. For working class families, it's more, you know, lack of time together because of the parents' work schedule or language barriers, because a lot of the times, I mean, the parents, they do not speak any English. They have very little interaction with, you know, the mainstream population. So those are the structural issues. You know, they don't see each other or they cannot communicate. That really contribute more to the whole alienation process at home. And then a lot of the middle class families is really this whole issue of dual frame of reference. Mm-hmm. That, so I mean, even though, for example, a parent can be working at Harvard or MIT, right? And we would assume that, you know, then the parent would speak more English, would be more acculturated to know more about the American customs, right? But what I find is really then their children are more likely to go to schools with predominantly white peers. So their children's acculturation speed still is a lot faster than the parents. Like in this one family, both parents work. One works in Harvard, one works at MIT, and you know, but they still interact in their social world mainly with Chinese friends. And a lot of their expectations a lot of things do not really get influenced that much by the, you know, the American values or beliefs. Does that answer your question? Mm-hmm. Yeah, please.
It seems like the dual frame of things of reference you mentioned and like parents working long hours, it seems like other immigrant families would also have the issues of Mexican immigrants in the Dominican Republic. So do you think it's mostly a cultural thing that makes Asian or Chinese American immigrant families act differently than
W? That's a really good question. Because a lot of the immigration related factors, right? I mean, they apply also to other groups of immigrant students, Mexican students, Haitian students. I mean, a lot of the language barrier or acculturation gap or even the long working hours, right, happens in other groups as well. But I think what really makes the Chinese case very different from the Mexican family is really the relative gap in terms of parental values, you know, parenting values. Really the gap between the Chinese parents, what they think of a good child, you know, what they think parent-child relation should be, that gap and the American, you know, way of parenting is somehow bigger than the Mexican and the U.S. For example, you know, one thing that came out really as a theme in the interview is Chinese students would say, you know, my mom would never praise me or hug me or, you know, like always so distant, right, compared to the American parents. But then a lot of the Mexican students, they wouldn't, like there is more, a lot of these issues are, you know, not that salient in the other is that clear or no? So it's really I think the cultural differences between the Chinese and the U.S. seem to be bigger, particularly at home. I think traditionally the confusion, the whole concept of a family, there's also more hierarchy, right? Much more than the U.S. culture or the other immigrant cultures. You know, I'm a parent, I expect you to really behave and follow, you know, I have to make all the decisions. There's a lot more that kind of behavior, and they're more strict. And so I think the differences between the parenting styles are more salient in the Chinese families, really leading to why there are more struggles.
Talk about the parent-children relationship, if it's the parallel development track or whatever it is, as if it's all bad. I would like to take the pieces that is really actually a very good thing. You know, when we have struggles, it's because we have different expectations. Perhaps the Chinese parents' high level of expectation that created all these anxieties in the children might have something to do with their being successful for the majority of them. If we keep focusing on the minority of the students, one have problem here, one have problem there, and therefore we lower our expectation of our children, I'm not so sure it's a good thing for all of us. I think we should be focusing on helping the students to even achieve bigger accomplishments. I'd like to ask the question of, we keep comparing the Chinese with the community students that are maybe less successful. I'd like to ask the question, have you compared the Chinese with the Jewish immigrants? What would be your results then, and how have they performed?
Right. I mean, that's, I'm glad you asked that question. This is a really good question because it really make me think about why, right, I present this work or why I'm interested in this topic. And I think the whole issue of high parental expectation, it's really, that's the double-edged sword I am talking about. On the one hand, it definitely lead to, right, make students more motivated. They do better. I mean, there's a reason, like, why the Chinese students are doing so much better than the other immigrant students. Maybe it's particular because of that. But I think, from my perspective, so much research really has been done on that. You know, we all know that. We all know parents have high expectations. It's really good for the students' achievement. But what I really was trying to get at, what I'm interested in, is if we look at, you know, what's the byproduct of that, of this high achievement we already know they can achieve. You know, why are they having such high level of psychological difficulties? And I guess that really goes back also to, you know, what do we want our children to be? Do we all want them to be high achievers, to be presidents, or, you know, or do we want them to be balanced, you know, to both do well educationally and also feel good? I mean, to have, yeah, so that really gets to the whole issue of how do you define, right, what's the end result of a development of a child? Which is really, I would love to hear other people's perspective on that. It's really a very interesting question. Do people have comments on that particularly?
Yes.
Yeah, please.
I totally disagree. But I teach, I grew up here. I when I was about 16, I teach in college.
Mm-hmm.
Well, just a little bit sidetracked, a little bit away from the topic. Because I noticed after all these years that I teach, I find out, to begin with, I told most of the Oriental, including Korean, Japanese, mm-hmm. and Chinese immigrant students, and I didn't differentiate whether it's first generation or second generation.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And notice their performance academically normally was were very good.
Mm-hmm.
But recently, I noticed there's a little bit some dropping.
Mm-hmm.
And some of the students, Chinese or Japanese students, they don't perform as well.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I saw their predecessors before.
Mm-hmm.
So I just wondered, I kind of asked them, if some of them, they are, you know, they have all this problem to say, well, we are expected by our panel of peers too high. Don't compare with us with them. We need some time to do our own thing.
Right.
We got to catch up with, you know, with the age, with modern days, with all in a game and this and that. We have, we don't have that much time to put on the academic things.
Mm-hmm.
Besides, what good is that? You can't find a job anywhere. And then we have an IT job, you know, I'm teaching electrical engineering.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of people, you know, a lot of students come to me and say, can I find a job after I graduate from here?
Mm-hmm.
Especially people, you know, first, you're a student from the background of first generation.
Mm-hmm.
I say, well, I cannot guarantee that.
Mm-hmm.
No job is hot at this moment.
Right.
You just pick whatever you like.
Right.
Yeah. Don't go by your parents' expectations.
But are these students that you're talking about, the Japanese students, are they
Chinese?
Are they later generations or are they recently arrived immigrant students?
I think they are either, you know, when they came in at teenage,
mm-hmm.
or
I see.
A little bit earlier,
mm-hmm.
or
mm-hmm.
maybe after high school.
Mm-hmm.
And it seems they don't, well, they want a good school but without putting too much effort.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's also hard.
Right. Right. Now it becomes this kind of habit. So I say, hey man, you can't do this. You got to either, you know, or harder.
Right.
Sacrifice some of your entertainment.
Right. I mean, so it's really, I mean, the definition of success, right?
Right.
How do we define success?
Balance between,
right.
Between whether they want to have some time for themselves.
Right.
To cope with the time, or they want, you know, have time for academic work.
Right, right.
So it's kind of hard. So I noticed the parents, you know, when I was, you know, little kid, when I was in school, and my parents, they have that kind of expectation.
Mm-hmm.
And I normally, what they got is my backfire.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know.
Mm-hmm. And that's another issue. You know,
so
how long?
Thing, and also, okay, back to the track. One of my friends, he is a very, well, somewhat intellectual.
Mm-hmm.
I know there's a two group. One's an intellectual family, one's a low class, I mean, a working class family. The intellectual family, they do have a better communication with the kid. Because they could present themselves socially.
Mm-hmm.
They could go attend a parent seminar
mm-hmm.
to
to attend even more than those working class.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Due to language barrier and mm-hmm. their intellectual level and all that. And also presentation, presentable.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they can
children don't feel embarrassed.
Yeah, more confident.
Mm-hmm.
And those working class parents, they kind of shy away from it.
Mm-hmm.
They're so scared. Oh, I don't speak English, no English.
Right.
So, and also the way they dress and the way they present themselves, sometimes the children don't want their parents to preach.
Right.
Present in
right.
They feel shame of the parents.
Right.
A lot of, I have some friends, you know, working class friends, the children just come back and tell them, why don't you just hide away? I don't want you to learn about other people.
I mean, it's such a tragedy because parents really come to this country for the education of the children, right? I mean,
right.
a lot of the immigrant parents,
right.
and then they send the kids to school, and then they lose their children psychologically.
Besides, those parents, they don't, because the argument with children from that kind of family
mm-hmm.
is, you know that I'm a paradise. I'm ashamed of you. So how can you smoke? And you do all this, you talk bad and talk vulgar language, and now you're expecting to be a gentleman, to be a lady? Come on, teenage girls. They have that kind of attitude, right?
That's a good,
so
that's a good point.
So, of the intellectual family, I was talking about my friend, and I asked him.
can I?
One quick one. He didn't want his kid to learn piano and this and
right.
And finally, why? I said, why do you want him to do that? Why? Because I want to learn myself when I was a kid. I have no chance.
Right.
And I want to impose this on him.
Mm. Right. Yeah. Right. So the it goes back, right?
Right?
I mean, to the whose life is it? You know, is it the
right.
child's or is it the parents? And it's really yeah. Please, I know there are a couple. Yeah, please.
Actually, I'm gonna defend him a little.
Okay.
I don't think it's necessarily parenting style that should be attacked here.
Mm-hmm.
I think a bigger concern is that some of these students are suffering from clinical level depression that leads to suicide.
Mm-hmm.
And why isn't that being treated?
Mm-hmm.
Right? We know that it's not just environmental factors
right.
that leads to that
right.
type of depression,
right.
but it's a strong biological component.
Right.
And that should be looked at and zeroed in on. And I think the bigger problem here is that these parents and these families are not aware that people seek psychological counseling,
right.
not just for a DSM diagnosis. I mean, most people who come to counseling in America, they come
mm-hmm.
with some vaguely articulated notion of unhappiness
mm-hmm.
or poor interpersonal relationships, or just come here and they just come here and say, I don't know how to be, I don't know how to live, I'm a little unhappy, and
mm-hmm.
you know, I need you to help me sort things out.
Mm-hmm.
And immigrant families need to know that, you know, seeking psychological counseling is not something to be ashamed of.
Right. Right.
You know, it's a great
right.
it's a great tool for adjusting and
right.
helping interpersonal relationships along.
Right.
You know, just to deal with anxiety.
Right.
And being on psychotropic meds, if you're depressed to the point where you're contemplating suicide,
mm-hmm.
I think your parent placing pressure on you is the bigger problem here.
Mm-hmm.
I think the depression that's not being treated is the bigger problem
mm-hmm.
here. Also, Duke University professor, I don't remember her name, but she did a study on same topic, was it Chinese kids outperform other minorities.
Mm-hmm.
And what she found was that the parenting style that Chinese parents use is actually the optimal parenting style. They're
mm-hmm.
authoritative,
right.
which means they apply the right amount of pressure and support,
mm-hmm.
which is
mm-hmm.
a similar style that Jewish families use. So I think he was a little right when he said it's not the parents who should be attacking here,
mm-hmm.
their parenting style.
Mm-hmm.
There are other factors to be considered.
Mm-hmm. That's a very good point.
Mm-hmm.
we have a rally here. Oh, yeah. Yeah, and the whole underutilization of psychological service is a really very big issue, right?
Suicide.
Mm-hmm.
It shouldn't get to that point.
Mm-hmm.
Parents should notice that. Teachers should notice that. Peers should notice that.
Right.
You know,
but I mean, a lot of the challenges we see at school. What I was really trying to make across the point is really, you know, because of this dominant image, right, of they're fine. You know, these
yeah.
students, they don't need any help. So that's why a lot of their needs, right, a lot of the things can escalate
mm-hmm.
to this point. If, you know, earlier on, you know, teachers know that, you know, a student is sitting there not seeing anything, doesn't mean he or she is doing completely fine. If they know that earlier on, if there is earlier intervention, then it wouldn't lead to that, definitely. And I definitely do not want to say it's all the parents' fault. No, that's definitely not the point here. So thank you for your comments.
I was actually thinking that isn't there like a higher prevalence rate of like parents of Asian descent using like authoritarian parenting though? Like maybe Muslims still use authoritative, but just I think isn't there like a higher percentage rate of like authoritarian style parenting just because of the fact that you're supposed to show respect to your elders,
mm-hmm.
so they sort of think like they're like whatever thing is the right way, so this tends to lead to like an authoritarian style of parenting.
Mm-hmm.
So.
I mean, research really, I mean, they distinguish between two kinds of parenting, authoritarian and authoritative, right? So the authoritarian parents in the literature are supposed to be, you know, they're not good for the, you know, for the children. But what we find, I mean, what literature has found in the case of the Asian families is really authoritarian when parents are strict, right? At the same time, supportive. It actually leads to higher educational achievement of the students. So it doesn't fit the model. The experiences of the Asian families do not fit that model. And Ruth Chow, I think a psychologist at UC, she really wrote about this whole issue of authoritarian parenting. She interviewed parents to understand, you know, what's the parents' perspective on authoritarian parents? You know, why are they being strict to their children? And she also talked about really parents do that not because they just want obedience, it's more they care about the children, they show their care and love by being strict because it's good for their future and
I was also thinking that in like schools with a higher percentage of like Asian American students in it, mm-hmm. like is there an effect from like extra peer support maybe, and also the understanding that maybe other people's parents are similar to your own parents? does that help the
right.
students? Like maybe do they fare better, I guess, psychologically?
Right. I think I haven't seen, you know, studies that really tease out the different school contexts in terms of the ethnic composition of the student body and the effect of that on students' psychological and social adjustment. But I think from, you know, or if we hypothesize and think about it, it wouldn't be surprising, right, if you're surrounded by peers, you know, who are from the same culture, you know, if parents are also, have other parents, have a network of parents. So that would be the gap between the parents and children may not be that big versus a student who is the only Asian student in the whole class. You know, everybody else is American and white, and so the conflict there may be bigger. So that's a really important context. Yeah, please.
How are you doing? I'm a high school teacher in the Bronx, so I'm not a Bronx science, so I don't deal with many Asian students, but I am from San Francisco, California, mm-hmm. and I'm very familiar with the case that you're talking about the student. The high school, they're called Mull High School. It's probably one of the most competitive schools in California
mm-hmm.
Out there. I've gone to schools with Chinese American students. I've been a teacher with Chinese American students. Regardless of what, you know, the double-edged sword thing, it's very disturbing. You put all the academic aside, college achievement, you know, to be a professor, all these things that are pressure there. When a child, that regardless if you're Dominican, if you're black, if you're Chinese, or mm-hmm. you know, whatever you are, is unhappy with who they are, I think, and as a statistic, so I said, well, there has to be, we got to put the brakes on something. Because that's more important, your child's happiness is more important than anything that could ever be. But then it shows at the same time that the academic achievement is so good, but you're unhappy, there's something that's very, very wrong there.
Mm-hmm.
And I think, and I want to ask you or other people in here, I mean, how is there ways to articulate it? And I know from my own friends and from my own students, who I later became a teacher, Chinese American students, that mm-hmm. that the stress that is put upon the shoulders to reach these academic levels, like if you get an 89, you come home in shame because you didn't get a 98
right.
on a
mm-hmm.
test. That's not necessarily, some people may argue different, but as a teacher and also as a parent I know, that's not necessarily healthy for the development of a young person because
mm-hmm.
it's going to keep them in a state of anxiety. So I'm asking you and maybe other people, when I do return back to San Francisco again, have more Chinese students, again, how is there a way to articulate community to parents? This is not necessarily the best way to development of like the soul of the human being or the person. It might be good that they could get a Cal Berkeley or NYU, but you know they're going to be 31 years old with still some scars from the past that they couldn't develop right. How do there ways to find a balance of it, and everything don't have to be upon a grade or a test score, and there's other much more important factors of their own happiness? Because I got homies that are 30 years old back home, and they going buck wild, and they was getting 4.0s back in the day, and they said, I didn't want that. I'm dropped out. I got to college. I just want to go to the club and kick it. I'm telling you, because I didn't have no time to have fun. I didn't have, because I was like this for 13, you know, all through college, and then I just snapped, and now I'm just, you know, so there's, you know, we're still human beings, regardless of you're Chinese or whatever. You know what I'm saying? So how would you address that with parents?
That's really, I would love for all of us to think about that. I mean, I really, a couple of things came up when you were talking about that. I remember I was talking to a friend of mine, you know, who has two daughters. One of them, you know, does a lot of dancing and took part in this dancing competition. She's from Bulgaria and her children all grew up here. And she said, you know, everybody got a medal in the end of the competition. You have the first medal, you have the second medal, you have the third. I mean, all 15. Competitors get a medal. You know, everybody is happy, you know. So there's a, I think the cultural approach, you know, to achievement is so different. There's so much more praise here, right? We have to pay attention to the student's self-esteem. We have to make them feel good. You know, little bit thing that they did, we have to praise them. I mean, and that approach versus, like, I grew up in China, you know, I went through the whole education system in China. I remember in high school, we have 60 students in my class. And at the end of the school year at PTA meetings, from number one to number 60, everybody in the class, each one of your subject score is listed in that one piece of paper. Number one, you know, to number 60. Like how much you got in math, how much you got in, you know. So it's a completely different approach. And I think it's really hard, you know, for us to say to the Asian parents, you know, forget about that approach. You know, now try to make your children happy. I think there's so many sociological reasons, right, why parents push their children so hard. I mean, if you look at the Asian American history of immigration, you know, I mean, all the model minority that started in the 60s, but before that, there was so much discrimination. I mean, there was the Chinese exclusion. I think a lot of people know. So the opportunity structure was not open for a very, very long time to the Asian people. And I think for, you know, Asian parents, Chinese parents here, they really, you know, they don't have the privilege of saying, well, you can just party and have a good time. It's really, you know, in order to have upward mobility, education is the only route that they see can make that happen. So it's really a more, not just a definition of success and we can change that. It's really a larger issue. And even now, I mean, there's still a lot of discrimination. There's still a lot of glass ceiling for Asian Americans. I think it's really important to address a lot of the larger social issues before we can say to parents, now you can relax. And that's my perspective. Do other people have a, yeah, anything?
I just wanted to say, somebody who teaches college, I see a lot of very high achieving students, and a lot of students from all communities who've been pushed very hard by their parents, and who really are working because the parents are putting this pressure on them. And as somebody who's looking for bright kids to send on to graduate school, I would say I have some issues empirically what I've observed, because I'm not sure there is this great correlation between parental pressure and success. In that, by the time they get to college, these kids, I find that, again, this is just empirical, but there is a plateau that's reached. And if you want to really, at that level, get real talent, kids who are really going to be original and inventive and you know, the Nobel laureates in the future or whatever, I'm not sure that it's the kids who have just been pushed and trained. I find it, I've seen it with students first adolescence, you know, which is where every parent wants their kid to go.
Right.
So I don't know about this, whether this is that. Of course, those kids are successful.
Right.
Maybe in monetary terms, and they get the jobs.
Right.
But whether they go that one level beyond,
right.
I haven't seen that. it's going to be a larger kid who's still original, who might have just, you know, go on and prove the real fear. So I wondered if you had anything to say about that. They are, these kids are operating within this culture. At the end of the day, they don't feel that the ideas belong to them. They
So you're saying there's really a limit, right? How much parents can push their children to achieve.
Certainly within this culture.
I mean, even...
It's frustrating because you have, you know, a kid comes in incredibly well trained and does everything you're asking of them. By the time they're a junior, they're still stuck where they were as freshmen. And the other kids who've taken over didn't start out so, so-called promising. But they came into their own, and they're the ones who are going through my writing recommendation letters to those graduates. And I think what maybe personally is like we're talking about coming to play, but it's a lot about just ownership of what you do. I know someone who judges the Intel science competition, which is like the biggest science competition. And she said she interviews a lot of South Asian students, but they never, they come to the finals, but they never win. Because when you ask, why are you doing this? What is the meaning behind all of this? There's no answer. And that's not who taught science and mathematics, which is what I'm going to tell you. It's done because you have an original fresh mind.
I mean, there is, that's really definitely a very valuable perspective, right, from your own observations. I think there's so much variation, you know, within the, like, you know, the Asian student, you know, like there's so much diversity in terms of the experiences of the students. But I think there has been, like, the concern in the community, right, about the whole overemphasis on a lot of the science or math on that track in college versus the more creative art or writing or, because that traditionally is not seen as being, you know, successful. You will not get high-paid jobs, really economically stable from parents' perspective. And it also reminds me of, you know, like the whole Chinese educational system, how they're trying to make it more student-centered, try to, you know, really encourage more creativity rather than, you know, just learning, like rote learning or memorization. So it's really...
I mean, I'm not only speaking about Chinese students, I'm speaking about the students I see who have clearly a lot of sort of parental pressure.
All the students who are pushed by their parents.
So I'm not, I wouldn't be able to judge particular groups. I would just say that's something I've noticed about the students I get to know who've been pushed very hard.
And you wonder at what point, how much can parental expectation and pressure sustain, right? I mean, can students sustain that throughout, you know, graduate school, their whole life? It's really, I mean, these are all really very important questions.
Yeah. I was just thinking, you know, with your findings, if we can then at least temporarily until somebody come up with better idea to make the parents, you know, alert, be alert of all that's going on, and that they then will be more willing to learn maybe parenting skills, some, you know, and maybe hug their children a little bit more, use more encouraging words than, you know, putting them down, and, you know, and also maybe encourage young people to, you know, to, I mean, at least maybe have peer groups or something. And also, how should I put it? You know, like,
so really to facilitate parent-children communication. And one thing I do want to really note.
Maybe pull out the signs of depression. So, you know, like the parents and also their peers would be able to recognize mm-hmm. the symptoms of depression.
Mm-hmm.
You
mm-hmm.
know, because the Chinese parents, you know, they just say, okay, the kids don't, they don't, they're not talking to me. They are not recognizing, you know, maybe sleeplessness or
right.
Mm-hmm. not having no appetite, mm-hmm. or the different symptoms of depression,
mm-hmm.
you
mm-hmm.
know. So these are some of my thoughts.
Yeah, so really trying, right. like for all of us to try to think about what can we do, right? What are right. some things that right. we can
and
do
we
to really...
We want to keep the level of accomplishment.
Right, right. We want to have both worlds.
I think it's very important to think about these things and think about solutions and mm-hmm. the clinical problems and deal with them.
Right.
Mm-hmm. My thesis is we need to deal with this other negative symptoms or whatever it is, but the solution mm-hmm. is not going to be reducing parental expectations.
Mm-hmm.
That
mm-hmm.
will be the end of all these things.
mm-hmm.
We need to keep that up and deal with the other problems, not to say we need to reduce our expectations so that we don't have those problems.
Mm-hmm. And a lot of really what I was trying to really convey is not the expectation per se, it's really the communication around that. You know, how parents and children talk about it. For example, one thing students complain is that, you know, very common experience, if I get bad grade, you know, the parents will be really upset and not talk to me for days. If I get a good grade, they never say anything. You know, like there's no positive reinforcement. So not necessarily, yeah, so I think there must be things that, you know, we can do, you know, programs we can, you know, run really to talk to parents about how children feel and talk to children about how parents feel. I think a lot of the parallel is that they do not talk to each other and they completely operate, you know, from their own expectation, right? Not being able to see the whole thing from the perspective of the other. I also want to note that a lot of this work is really done, my work has been done on adolescents. But the whole issue of parent-child conflict or, you know, identity, a lot of these issues are very much developmental. Like, the highest level of conflicts you may see, you know, at high school, that's when, you know, all the issues were brought up and parents and children, really their relationship break down. But then a lot of the times you hear stories of, you know, they go to college, you know, they get to, you know, be in Asian American student associations and get to meet more other students, they read more, they learn more about their culture and history, then they rebuild relationship with their parents. They begin to appreciate, right, what the parents did, the sacrifice. So it's really a lot of these issues are not just, you know, there it is, never changes. A lot of them are constantly changing, but I think at the high school level, it would be helpful if we can do something to really improve some of the situation. Yeah.
I just want to say that I think that Professor Chin will stay around and talk to all of us on more questions. So maybe if we limit, say, to three more questions or comments, and then Dr. Chin will stay around and talk to all of us for some more. And I'd just like to take that opportunity.
Do we count that as one of the three?
The teacher from the Bronx, mm-hmm. that is, you know, in terms of, say, you know, some sort of intervention with, parents about their expectation and the whole communication aspect, and how do you actually convey that message to the parents? And I think that one of the things that may be possible is to work through